Om Apyayanta Vamangani Vak Pranas Chakshu Shrotram Athabalam Indriyani Chasarvani Sarvam Brahmopanishadam Maham Brahma Nirakuryam Mama Brahma Nirakarot Anirakaranam astu, anirakaranam me astu, tadatmani nirateya upanishatsu dharmaste mahisantu, te mahisantu, om shanti shanti shanti, om. I pray to the Divine Lord that all aspects of my personality, my body, mind, sense organs, strength and the prana shakti may all increase and function in perfect concert. This whole physical universe, visible through the sense organs, is nothing other than the ultimate reality described as Brahman in the Upanishads. May I always keep this truth in mind. May I not reject this truth. May I strive in this life to make this my direct experience. As I am engaged in this effort, may all the virtues such as truthfulness, strength, purity, straightforwardness described in the Upanishads, may all those virtues come and reside in me. May all those virtues come and reside in me. Om peace. May there be peace in our hearts. May there be peace and harmony amongst all beings, and may there be peace everywhere in the whole of nature. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Namaskar. Very happy to be here. This is my hometown in America. As Hari mentioned, when I left India, for the first time ever, everything said an airplane. I'd never been in any air travel. So, first place where I landed was Pittsburgh at the in winter month, December 27 or 28. It was so cold and so full of snow. I'd never seen snow in my whole life. It was a very thrilling experience. Lot of adventure, but by the grace of Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother Swamiji, everything worked out well, and I'm here again, once again, visiting this wonderful place. This topic, the practice of the presence of God, I took this title from a book by Brother Lawrence, who was a Christian monastic brother, Carmelite monastic brother in the 17th century in France. That is his teaching, how to constantly practice the awareness, practice the presence of God, be aware of the presence of Godliness. All the scriptures and sages have said, based on their experience, that God is present in all. We will see those passages in the study guide. If that be so, why are we not experiencing or seeing God's presence in us? That's the question. Again and again, the scripture says, sages have said that we have seen God, as Sri Ramakrishna said to Naren. And he said, I am seeing God more clearly, more vividly than I am seeing you. And it can be seen. So our question is, how can we also gain that experience directly in our lives? What can we do? What prevents us from doing it? Why it is not happening? And what can be done? What can we do to gain that experience? That is the subject matter. For this study guide, I have taken many passages, 124 passages from various scriptures listed at the end. And everything I have to say, I can say, is already there. I don't need to speak anything. You can just read the material and that may be enough. Now, there's not much else. I'm going to say that it's not already there in this study guide. But by way of introduction, I want to say very briefly a few words about Pramana. The first topic in the outline is on page 1, God is real, everything is God. How do we know that? That is the question. So in Vedanta, they use certain methods to arrive at truth. These methods by which they arrive at truth, something that can be called true, are described in the works of philosophy in great detail. And I don't have that much knowledge of philosophy, but very briefly, there are 6 pramanas that are used by various systems of Indian philosophy. 6 systems of Indian philosophy, they use these, some of them use these 6 pramanas. And I will simply list them here. And if you want to know more details, I'll give you a source from where you can get all that information. So this only thing I'm going to write during this weekend. There's not much else, everything else is already here. They call this pramana. Right. Yes, this right. Methods of arriving at truth. There are 6 of these. And I don't know the details of all these things, but some things I will mention. One method by which we arrive at something is by referring to the scriptures, Shruti, scriptures for this purpose, for Vedantic purpose, or the Upanishads. Though there are many kinds of scriptures, Shruti, Smriti, Puranas, so many other books are there, Prakarana Granthas. For this purpose, to arrive at the truth about the existence of a divine power behind this universe, one pramana is Shruti pramana. Shruti means scripture, Upanishads. In the Upanishads, various sages have expressed spontaneously their own revelations and experiences. What the rishis have said in the Upanishad, they are not theoretical philosophies that they gathered by reading various books, but each one of them, Upanishadic sages, they experience it themselves directly in their own lives. Our experience cannot be expressed in words. Even simple, ordinary, day-to-day experiences cannot be put in words accurately. That being so, this divine experience of one's own divine nature cannot be expressed in words. But for the time being, words are the only means which we have for communication.
until we get our own experience. Why this experience cannot be explained in words is very clear. Let us take a very ordinary day-to-day experience. When I first came to this country, during the course of conversation, I told a fellow student about jackfruit. Jackfruit? He said, "What is jackfruit?" American student, fellow student, he had no idea. Then I tried to explain to him what jackfruit is. Those days there was no hologram, all those things were not there. So early before all the computers came. So as much as I could explain in words, but he didn't have any faintest idea of what a jackfruit is. So then what to do? Then I said the only way you can know the taste of jackfruit is if you actually eat one yourself. But those days jackfruits were not available in Indian stores. Now they are available in Indian stores and Korean stores. You can buy segments of jackfruit and eat. So he could not be convinced. I said, is it sweet like apple? No, not like apple. It is sweet like pears. Not like pears. Everything sweet. But this sweet in its own way. Jackfruit tastes like jackfruit, like nothing else. There's nothing else that tastes like jackfruit. So it's not possible. It's a daily experience anyway. There's no special qualification required to eat jackfruit and gain the experience. Even that cannot be explained in words. How can you know them? By himself experiencing it. Himself has to somehow procure jackfruit, have jackfruit nowadays is available. Then only he knows what jackfruit tastes like. So experiences cannot be put in words. How does the other person know? He has to experience himself or herself. We can tell him how to get jackfruit. But that's all. But he has to get it and eat it for himself. So that is the position of the rishis, the Vedic rishis. They experienced the presence of God in them. The Upanishad, they don't use the word God, they use the Brahman and Atman. And they wanted to explain their experience, but they, as much as they put in words, they did. But they told us, how can we go about experiencing ourselves, gaining that experience ourselves? So that is one. Shrutis have said, Shrutis means these rishis which had experience, who had experience, they said, so it must be true. Because they were all separate in centuries, across centuries in different areas. There was no way they could have communicated. Independently they experienced and each one of them explained his experience. This is how God is, Brahman is. So that you can take as a starting position. That only gives us a starting hypothesis. Yes, there must be God or Brahman. Then we have to proceed to experience ourselves in our own lives. So the second way, method that the philosophers use is anumana, inference. Is one other way to know that there is something that is not visible. Based upon something that is visible, which we can see, we can infer the presence of something that is not visible. The example that they give in scriptures is, supposing you see a cloud of smoke in the sky at a distance. Smoke is rising and you are traveling somewhere at a distance. Then what can you infer from the smoke that you are able to see? Smoke is an object you can see with our eyes. By seeing something which is present, which is visible, we can safely come to the conclusion that there must be fire causing the smoke. So it's well known that only fire causes smoke. If there is fire, there is smoke. So by looking at something, the effect, visible effect, smoke is a visible effect. We can retrospectively infer the presence of fire, invisible at the moment. Then you can go near and see fire also. By seeing something visible, effect, invisible cause can be inferred. That's another way to arrive at the existence of something which cannot be seen. Invisible cause, visible effect, leading us back to invisible cause. Another example familiar that you read in the scriptures is, if you see a pot, earthen pot, they use earthen pot in India to store water and other things. What should we infer? Somebody must have made the pot. Pots don't occur in nature. There must be a person, a potter, who must have taken the clay and given it the shape of a pot and baked it and kept it there. So, but he is not there. When you go to a shop, you see the only the pots there. Potter made it someplace else and the retailer brings it and sells it in the shop, pottery shop. So if you can infer the presence of a potter, this is a visible product. Anybody can see a pot. But by looking at a pot, the invisible cause of that source of that pot can be inferred. You can safely conclude that must have been a potter. An efficient, intelligent cause must be there. An intelligent cause must be there. Define this pot. That kind of arriving at knowledge is called anumana, or inferential knowledge. Then they use another method. Upamana. Comparison. We can visualize the appearance of something that is not visible by seeing something which is visible. For example, these two things on scripture says as God is, Brahman is there, God is there. But you are not able to see it ordinarily with our present instruments of perception. Then how can we gauge what kind of thing it is? Then they say, it is present everywhere. RVAP. What is present everywhere? Space is present everywhere. Like space, they say. Akashavat. Space is present everywhere. Wherever you go, there is space. There may be something else or not, but space is there. Present everywhere. Like space. All pervasive. God is all pervasive, present everywhere. It's a quality. But invisible. Space cannot be seen. Can you see space? No. When you see sky, you are seeing the blue color. Or you can see the clouds, which may be any color. But if the clouds are not there clear, sky, then you see only blue color there. That blue color is not the color of the sky. Like the water appears blue from a distance. From a distance, if you see from the airplane, the swimming pool or river, or from a distance the sea appears blue. But when you go near the sea, take some water in your hand, that water is not, it's colorless. But from a distance it appears blue. So space appears blue. There is no color. This space has no color, no shape, no size, present everywhere. Like that, Atman is present everywhere. It has no particular shape or size or quality guna. There is no quality, attributeless, everywhere present. Like that, you can infer the nature of Atman. Then there are two more things, three more things. They call something arthapatti. I don't know the English word for this one. Arthapatti means similar to anumana. The example they gave in the books, or there is a person named Devadatta. You can give any name, it does not matter. Person is standing there. Everybody can see him. That person appears to be well fed. Lot of weight he has put on. But nobody has seen him eat during the day. During the day he doesn't eat anything. When people are watching, he doesn't eat anything. And everybody goes to him and he goes to his home. Then next day when you see him, he's not lost any weight. Yesterday he didn't eat anything. Next day he doesn't eat anything. But he's putting on weight. So what do you include? What do you conclude? You conclude that when nobody is watching, he must be eating at night. That's similar to upamana, similar to anumana, kind of inferential knowledge, like that. And there is one more thing which is even less well understood by me, at least. That is anupalabdhi. It's not important to know these things, but since the topic is what is, then philosophers use these various methods to theoretically arrive at the presence of something which cannot be seen, but not important from the sadhaka's point of view. From the sadhaka's point of view, this can be skipped. Anupalabdhi. It's still less understood. There's one mantra in the Keno Upanishad, chapter 1, sloka 3. It says, the Rishi says, the Brahman cannot be seen, but it is there. How do you know? I have experienced it. My experience is my experience. You have to gain your own experience. So the mantra is, na tatra chakshur gacchati tatra, and Brahman chakshur na gacchati. Eyes do not go, eyes cannot see Brahman. It's not an object like this wall or somebody to be seen. It's very subtle, too subtle. Sukshma sukshma tara. Subtler than the subtlest. Na vak gacchati. Speech cannot explain. There is no word to explain Brahman. You cannot say Brahman is big or small or kind or compassionate. There is no adjective possible to describe Brahman. Indescribable. No manaha. Mind also cannot conceive of it. It's beyond the domain of speech and mind. Speech and mind can grasp everything except the ultimate reality, which is beyond the domain of speech and mind. Expression, no words cannot explain, thoughts cannot also conceptualize in your mind. Never Brahman. How can we know then? How do we know it is there? You can know the experience. You can experience it. So that's the last one. That one is pratyaksha anubhava. Direct or aparoksha anubhuti. This is not sensory experience. This experience, Atmanubhava, is not sensory, you cannot see it. Five sense organs of perception, Janendriyas, you know. You cannot know through these five sense organs. You cannot touch it, you cannot taste it, you cannot smell it, you cannot see it, you cannot hear it. These are the five indriyas. But beyond the sense, ultra-sensory perception, supra-sensory perception, experiencing oneness with it, cannot be explained. How to know? Experience it yourself. How to get experience? Methods are there. Methods, they all told how to get this experience that you can follow. So that is their experience. Now these are these traditional 6 months. Six pramana they use. In different philosophies. But if you are interested to pursue this subject of pramanas in more detail, I can suggest one source. It's a scholarly kind of book. Unless you are deeply interested, it's hard to read it. There was a Swami Satprakashananda in St. Louis, he was there. The Swamiji had was from Bangladesh originally. He had seen Swami Vedanta, Swami Satprakashananda. And he was the only one living at that time that I knew that had seen Swamiji. Somehow I came to know, so I went to see him. So that Swami was a great scholar. In St. Louis, he was there before Swami Chaitanyanandaji came. He wrote a book, he wrote this book called The Methods of Knowledge. That is the name of the book, title of the book, The Methods of Knowledge. You can buy this book and read. But I caution it's very scholarly type of book. Unless you are deeply interested in this philosophical kind of topic, this is enough. What you are going to study today until Sunday are all practical things. Nothing, no philosophy here. Things that we can actually understand and we can actually do, we have to do. To ourselves, each one of us experience the presence of God in us. That is where we have to emphasize. What we have to emphasize. So he wrote that book. That contains all this information, philosophy, everything. But then we will stop this topic here, and here onwards until the end of our weekend program, we'll focus on practical things which we can actually put into practice. That's what brings the result. So we'll stop this pramana topic here for the time being. And go to the study guide. There are 124 passages grouped under 15 topics, and some topics have subdivisions in them. So the first group
First topic is, on page 1, God is real, everything is God. Now what we see in the first 10 passages, on page 1 and 2, passages 1 to 10, they are all Shruti Pramana, taken from the Upanishads, and some from Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is not actually Upanishad, but it enjoys the same status as Upanishad. It is Srimad Bhagavad Gita to Upanishad, so among other Upanishad, Gita is also Upanishad. We give the status of Upanishad, though it is not a really Upanishad. It's part of Mahabharata, as we know. So these 10 passages are taken from, to illustrate Shruti Pramana, what the Shruti says, scriptures say about the presence of God. Most of these are familiar to you from very earlier studies. So we'll go through them. Chandragya Upanishad, first one, Sarvam Kalavidam Brahma Tajjalaniti Shanta Upasita. Idam in Vedantic terminology means this visible universe. That means that invisible Brahman. These are pronouns. Idam means this, that means that. When you use the word this, we are referring to something here close by. This book. Otherwise I say that book far away from me. This is world is real right now. Although it's the other way in experience, it's very real. I can feel everything, I can see, touch, feel, and hear everything. I can talk to people, or I can hear what they say. It's all very real. But Brahman is so remote, appears abstract, something in the books. No idea of what it is at this moment. So call it that, far away. Seems to be far away, though it is the nearest of the near. Idam sarvam, this whole universe is nothing other than Brahman. Sarvam phalvidam Brahma. And that is the source of everything. Here you see cause and effect and cause, product and source. This source of this whole universe is Brahman. Tajja means the whole universe has emanated, come out from the Brahman. This whole universe is sustained by the power of Brahman, and this whole universe goes back into Brahman, recedes back into its source at the end of the world cycle. Gita also says same thing. Avyaktadini bhutani vyaktamadhyani bharata. All these beings that we see, not only human beings, animals, plants and planets and stars and everything, whole thing. Avyaktadini, they were in the avyakta, unmanifest state before, at the beginning. Vyaktamadhyani, now in the middle state they are vyakta, they are manifest, you can see they are there. Avyaktanidrani, when they finish their existence here, they go back into the avyakta seed form, unmanifest form. You can't see anything, it is there in an unmanifest form. That is, everything is sustained by the power of Brahman, Tajjalaniti. It is Shanta Upasiti. In this way, we have to meditate on Brahman with a calm mind. If the mind is agitated, we cannot do any kind of meditation. So you have to make the mind calm. Methods are there in the subsequent sections, how to make the mind calm, make it focused towards God. And then this Vishavasya Upanishad, beginning sloka, first sloka, is very famous. Ishavasyamidam sarvam yatkincha jagatyam jagat tena tyaktena bhunjita magradar kasya siddhanam kasya sviddhanam. You know these passages, so we'll just quickly go through them. All this, whatsoever exists in this changing universe, should be covered by Lord. Means we should see God in everything. Whatever we see, we are seeing Him alone. He is there. In these guys, He appears as people, good people, bad people, male or female, young or old, different nationals. But all these are various forms, like costumes. We are all, each one of us is a costume. And he is the one person wearing all the costumes, male costume, female costume, tiger costume, elephant costume, like that one. But he is the one, only one, wearing all the various costumes, having grand costume party, enjoying himself. That is explained in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad. There, the sage who had the experience of seeing everything as God, who had reached this experience, he exclaims. He says, Tvam stri tvam pamanasi, tvam kamara utava kamari, tvam jirno dande navanchasi, tvam jato bhavasi vishvato makaha. O Divine Lord, tvam stri, you alone appear in the form of all the female. Tvam paman, you alone appear in the form of all the male. Male and female are his forms. He is there inside. Forms are many, different. But content in all the forms is safety. Tam kumara utava kumari. You appear in the form of a kumara, means a boy, or in the form of a girl. When you see a girl, you should see what we see, the outer aspects. What dress she is wearing, what place she is studying in, all these things. No, but inside, the visible personality of this girl or boy, or man and woman, he is there, present. That you have to see. Tam jirno dande navanchasi. You appear in the form of an old man, jirna, dilapidated body, worn out body. Dande navanchasi, holding a staff or a walker, slowly, step by step, moving along, tottering along. Tam jato bhavasi vishvato mukha. You have all the faces of your faces. This theme will come through all these first 10 passages, same thing. Passage number 3, Yama says to Nachiketa. Nachiketa's question was, what survives the death after death? So, Atman survives. The body dies, but Atman remains. Nahanyate hanyamane sharire. In second chapter of Gita, there is one sloka number 20. There, Bhagavan Sri Krishna says same thing. That Atman na jayate namriyate kadachit. Nayam bhutva bhavitavana bhuya ajaha nityaha shashvata ayam puranaha nahanyate hanyamane. Sharire hanyamane, sharire hanyamane. Sooner or later it will go. But Atman remains. That's the nature of Atman. So Yama says in 3, Esha sarvesha bhuteshu gudaha Atmana prakashate. Buddha means remains hidden in all the beings, sarvesu bhuteshu, without any exception. There is no fine print with the exception of this God is present everywhere. No fine print in Vedanta, no contract. When they say, it is true. Sarvesu bhuteshu, in all the beings, regardless of nature of beings, living, non-living, good, bad, big or small, near or remote, does not matter. Sarvesu bhuteshu, Yesha Atma Guda, this Atman remains hidden from you. Na prakashate, does not come out and publicize itself. Look at me, I am here, Atman. The light doesn't say. Mind wants always publicity. Mind seeks publicity. I want to show myself as different from somebody else by wearing a different kind of cloth or by having some green hair, some other provocative. This t-shirt or something, people want to draw attention to them. So look at me, I'm here, I'm different. But Atman does not do that. Namprakashate, Udaha, it remains hidden from you. However, it can be seen to Abhyaya Buddhya Drishyate, Sukhmaya Buddhya Drishyate, Kaihi Sukhmadashibhi. But it takes a person who has developed subtle sense of perception, going beyond the gross appearance. Such a person with a subtle mind, with a strong focused mind, agriya buddhya, with a focused sharp mind, can see the presence of God in all. So just say we can see God in all and everything if we cultivate our mind, purify our mind. What is preventing us from seeing God, we'll see that later. This mind is a big shield obstruction. Impure mind. Pure mind is transparent. You will see that one later. And in Gita, 13th chapter, so many passages. Some are taken here. Number 4. Yavat samjayate kinchit sattvam sthavara jangamam kshetra kshetrajna samyogat tadvidyavarta shava. Whatever object you take in this creation, sattvam sthavara jangamam. Sattva means object. Sthavara means staying, things that don't move. Jangama means things that move, living, non-living, any kind of thing, anything at all in the universe, without any exception, whatever you take, it is a combination of two components. Kshetra, Kshetrajna, Samyogat. Samyoga means combination or union of two things are there. You take any person, male, female, younger, old, does not matter, sick or healthy, does not matter, rich or poor, does not matter. In that person, you can see two aspects. What is visible directly through the sense organs is the physical aspect, the body, mind, what dress he is wearing, what car he is driving, what language he speaks, what food he eats, what work he does. These are the things that we see. That's the physical, material, visible aspects. We see that in everyone. But we stop there. But those who have very sharp intellect, pure mind, they can pierce through the shell of the personality, which can be misleading sometimes, but see the presence of the divine inside. That kind of vision we have to develop, like laser vision. The mind of an ordinary person is like ordinary light. In a short distance, it will diffuse because all the waves are in different phases. But the mind of a rishi, a sage, who has done sadhana, his mind is like a laser beam. A laser beam does not have much diffusion. It can go straight without diffusion, long distances. It is so powerful, it can pierce the metals also. Our minds have to become so strong and so pure, like laser beam. Then we can pierce through the misleading shell of personality and see God in everyone. Personality is a big shield, appearance. Some are rich, some are poor, some are tall, some are short, like that one. Some are male, some are female, like that. But this is not the main thing. The visible part of our personality does not exhaust our personality. We are much more than what is visible from the outside. We are Atman inside. To see that and not be miscarried by what we see, physical part, we require to purify our minds, do sadhana. Two things are there in everything. Everything is a combination of moving and moving. Take this chair for example. Physical aspect we can feel, see, touch, etc. But spiritual dimension is there inside. You see a tiger, spiritual dimension is there. You see a good man, spiritual aspect is there. Bad person, same thing. It's there. It remain hidden from Buddha or Naprakashate, as Yama said. That spiritual part is common and one in all. Physical bodies are all different, they have to be different. My body is different from your body. But the spiritual part in me is same as spiritual part in you. There is only one singular Atman. Same Atman present in all the bodies. No different, no plurality there. Always only singular. Atman is always singular. But bodies are plural, many pluralities there, they have to be. How can this be? How can one thing be in different things? Take the example of space. If you go to the kitchen or some other place, lot of different containers are there. Some small cups, 8 ohm capacity, coffee mugs are there, 12 ounce glass is there, 1 gallon pot is there, 5 gallon container is there, all different shape, all different sizes, made of different material. But in all of them, what is there? Space. Only one space. Is indivisible space appears to be divided. Appears to be divided. Really not divisible. Only one. And continuous existence. Avibhaktam cha bhuteshu vibhaktam vichasthitam. Sri Krishna says in the Gita. So one Atman, continuous presence, undivided presence, indivisible presence in all the bodies. Sarvesha bhuteshu, esha atma, singular. That spiritual aspect is what? Who? See passage number 5, very important. That is second passage in the 13th chapter. There Bhagavan said directly, Kshetra means the body mind, like a field where crops are sown and harvest is reaped. The Kshetrajna means the person awareness principle inside, the Atman inside is one and only one singular. Who is that? He himself. Kshetrajnam chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetreshu bharata. In all the bodies, animal bodies, plant bodies, male bodies, female bodies, big bodies, small bodies, not only human, animals, plants, trees, planets, sun, stars, moon, everything, galaxies, everything, in all of them, mam ekam kshetrajnam vidhi, know me to be the one indwelling spirit. One thing appears in many things, appears to be divided into many parts, not really divided, cannot be divided. Space cannot be divided, so it is one, indivisible, appears to be separated. The space present in a container appears to have acquired limitations of the container for the time being. Really, it is not. If you have an empty conical flask in a laboratory, there is space in it. The space appears to be conical in shape. Or if the glass is made of green color, space in it appears to be green. But space cannot be conical, cannot be spherical, cannot be rectangular, no akara, no shape, cannot be green, cannot be yellow or anything. Those qualities are qualities of the container, not of the content. Bodies are all different. Some intelligent, some very dull people, some healthy people, some poor, some sick people, some animals, some plants, some ferocious animals, some nice animals. They're all the same Atman inside, only one singular Atman, pervading the whole of creation. That is the Atman that we have to know. And all the bodies are his dwelling places, abodes. That's in passage number 6. Swami Vivekananda quoted this verse in one of his lectures. Sarvatah Panipadam Tat Sarvatokshishiro Mukham Sarvatah Svatimal Loke Sarvam Avritya Tishtati. All hands are his hands. When you shake hands with somebody, you are shaking his hands. You see his presence in him. All feet are his feet. He walks through all the feet. All eyes are his eyes. All faces are his. When you see somebody's face, that is his face. He is there. Like that. All ears are his ears. He is hearing through all the ears. So I should tell the truth because he is hearing through all the pairs of ears. Supposing I tell you a lie, who is hearing it? He is hearing it inside your pair of ears. Like that. Sarvatokshi shiromukham sarvata shrutimat. All ears are his ears. Sarvam loke avritya tishtati. Pervading everything in this world, he alone remains. Only he sings. In all these various things we see, he is the real being inside. So we have to keep these things in mind when we see somebody. When you see somebody, wherever, in your workplace or family, or airport or wherever, or on the street, immediately remember, he is present in this person. Bring that thought to the mind. That person may make it difficult for you. Such an ugly, cruel person. How can you say God is present in this guy? Like that. That's a problem. The shape, the appearance poses a problem, obstruction. Whether that person is aware of this or not, whether he believes in it or not, his presence is unconditional. Whether I believe in God or not, I may dismiss the whole thing as something fiction, but he is present there, regardless of my belief. Unconditionally present everywhere. How do we know? Rishis have said, and our sages have said, and we too can gain that experience. Now, quickly go through remaining passages. Available. 7, this Gita shloka, everybody knows, Amma Atma Guna Kesha, from 10th chapter. 8th passage, and the next one that comes in the Gita is not here. Those are again Swamiji's favorite verses, he quoted in his lecture. 8th passage 38, chapter 13, shloka 27, very important shloka. Samam sarveshu bhuteshu tishthantam parameshwaram vinashyatsu avinashyantam yapashyati sapashyati vinashyatsu sarireshu vinashin sa tishthati. Bodies are perishable, containers are perishable, glass can get broken, earthen pot can get broken, but space does not get broken. When the pot goes, space remains. Like that, containers are human bodies, animal bodies, plant bodies, everything. They come and go, they change. But the content, which is the consciousness, he himself, kshetrajna in all, he remains unchangeable, unchanging, eternal, no change happens. The body is there or not, container is there or not, space is there. Even if there is no container, space is there. That is the way to visualize the presence of God in all. Sarvasya-tabhundi-sanyavishtha, we know that one. Ishra-sarabhodhanam-madhe-sharitana-tishtha. These are familiar passages from Gita, so you can study them. Now from 11 onwards, we go to another kind of pramana which is not listed there. Similar to pramana, but I will write it there. These are statements by illumined souls who have experienced God's presence in them, and based on their experience they are telling God is present in all of us. So this pramana is not known in the classical 6 months. You can say aptavakya. That means testimony of sages. Spiritual giants is included in the Shruti. But recent sages, you don't see Sri Ramakrishna's statements in any of the Upanishads, classical 10 Upanishads, you don't see. But what he said is exactly same as what the Upanishad says. And how did he say? When Sri Ramakrishna says, I saw God, on what basis did he say? Not on the basis of reading books, experience himself. That is why it makes it very valuable. I can also say God is present in all, but saying it as second-hand information taken from somewhere is different from saying it from your own experience. That's why we value that pramana very much. This is a strong motivation, a starting point for us. Sarva says a basis for our own spiritual quest. Because Sri Ramakrishna and other sages like him have said that they have seen God, God is present in all, that gives us a strong basis, a powerful motivation for us to start our own quest. They said, you too have to see, can see, they said that. That's why this is very important. So passage 10 onwards, 11 onwards, until the end of that section, 18 and next section, these are all words of illumined souls based on their own experience. So we can read this yourself. I'll read some of them. Passage number 12.